Hello and welcome to Connect, the weekly podcast of the California MBA featuring one-on-one interviews with movers and shakers in the mortgage industry. I'm Susan Malazzo, CEO of the California MBA, and very happy that you could join us today. Before I get to today's guest, I'd like to thank our Connect podcast sponsor, Incelerate.
Thanks, Susan, and thanks for listening. This is Josh Wren, CEO and founder of Incelerate. We're grateful for our partnership with the CMBA and are committed as a company to help lenders close more loans. We do this with our customer experience platform that has a CRM, lead management, marketing, automation, robust content library, desktop and mobile applications. We do this to help you engage and stay connected to your current borrowers, referral partners, past borrowers, and potential new ones. If you want to find out why we're the fastest growing CRM provider in the mortgage industry, please reach out to us and ask for a demo.
Okay, thank you, Josh. And with that, this brings me to today's guest. I'm very pleased to welcome Ned Payant, President of American Pacific Mortgage, to today's podcast. Ned, welcome.
Thank you very much, Susan. I appreciate you inviting me. I'm honored to be here.
Well, I had the great pleasure of knowing a lot of folks at APM, so it was nice to connect with you and have you on our episodes here. I do always like to kind of get started with a little bit of background. It's always an interesting story how people end up in the mortgage business. So you want to start out and give us a little bit about your journey to the mortgage business?
Sure. First of all, I'm wearing a jacket today, but I think it's 110 degrees in Sacramento when we're doing this. But for the CMBA, I'll wear a jacket for crying out loud.
Nice way. Shows dedication.
So, I mean, just real quick, again, thanks for having me. Just like every child's dream, start out, you know, do I want to be a baseball player or a fireman or a mortgage banker? And lucky for me, I got to be a mortgage banker. So I feel very, very thrilled and honored to be able to do that. But in reality, it was like every other mortgage story, kind of fell into it many years ago. Started out as a second job at night after I finished college. I went to work for a bank making what I thought were customer service calls, reminding folks that they had a mortgage payment to make. And I did that from 5 o'clock at night till 9 o'clock at night, Monday through Thursday. And,
wow.
And I quickly realized that this the mortgage business and the finance business was an interesting business. So I stuck with it. That nighttime job turned into a full-time job. And I rolled into from I guess I was in servicing for a short period of time. I went into home improvement lending for a number of years, and that was, you know, calling on contractors and remodelers and pool builders, and, you know, doing loans on Lowman, installment contracts and stuff like that. And then that transitioned into wholesale, and I spent a number of years on the wholesale side, running a large wholesaler for about 6 or 7 or 8 years, and then probably the last 15 years or so I've been on the retail side, and it's been a thrill. It's been great. I kind of had a background startup, came up with APM. I've been with APM American Pacific for 12 years now. Ran operations, ran production, and now I've got the great pleasure of serving our branches as the president for about the last 2 years. So that's kind of that's the long history. That's about 30 years right there in about 90 seconds, Susan.
That's the journey. You've had, I think, just like you've seen every side of the mortgage business. So that's unusual. Usually people are kind of like, I got in on this, and that's kind of the path that I stayed on. So you've kind of seen it all, from operations to servicing to wholesale and retail and everything in between.
Look, I've learned a lot. I still learn every day. I think probably you probably do in your role as well. You probably see a lot. It's been great. It's been fun. I work with wonderful people. I think there's great people in this industry. I think we're really blessed. It's really amazing how many people got into this industry by chance, but really, really smart, hardworking folks. And it's really been a joy. And the ability to help people and put people in homes and, you know, create family wealth and all of that stuff that we talk about. It really is. It's really been a great journey for me.
Yeah, that's all very real. That you kind of, I shared that with you. That's one of the reasons that I love my job. I love working with all the people in the mortgage industry. This crazy business, I'm like all the people that I get to work with, I just really enjoy them. I've met some true professionals. So one of my favorite parts about my job too. So as we talked, you know, you've had a long history in the mortgage industry. You know, we're mid to late 2022, and this is definitely a tough cycle that we're in. What can you share with our listeners about how to stay competitive in a market like this?
Well, you know, it is, man. You're absolutely right. 2022 it's been more difficult. It seems like it's getting more difficult each quarter. You know, everybody's kind of realigning with their projections for 2022, and what we thought in December is a lot different in March, and what we thought in March, a lot different in June, July, and August.
Yeah.
It's been wild, but you know, I think certainly for originators, for me, you know, talking about originators, because that's what, you know, we live and breathe with originators. It's about, you know, aligning with somebody. You know, it gets back to the basics. It's you know, it's product, you know, it's process, it's service, those things, pricing. If you know, you line yourself up with a company that provides the products that you need, competitive pricing, and a level of service. And ultimately, if you have a good deal of trust with the organization that you're with, I mean, that's how you get through tough times like this. You know, I think mostly there's two things. There's the growth side. I think it's important to always be growing, right? In our business is very important. And then the second side is managing the business and managing the P&L, particularly, you know, this year, managing the P&L is been very, very tough. And so, you know, from that aspect, I think that, you know, again, it's this year, the last 2 years was volume, volume, volume. I think for, you know, this year in 2022, I focus on market share more than volume. Volume is going to come ultimately if you do the right things to get add market share. And that's what I think everybody's probably going, trying to do in 2022, gain more market share. And, you know, I guess the last thing from, you know, technology is great. We go to we go to a CMBA events, we go to different events, and there's this great technology in our business, and more is coming every day, and I think that's great. But ultimately, I mean, it's a relationship business, and so, as good as technology is, it's not as important. It's really kind of great for us in this business that it is still a relationship business. But you got to do whatever it takes. You got to go out and create more relationships. That's why your CMBA is so great, because that helps in that regard, right? It really does. And it helps us as a member, but just organizationally, going out and getting one more good relationship, whether you're an originator or whether you're a company, whether you're looking at partnering with another technology, I think the relationship piece will certainly help us get through the next, I don't know what, 6 months, 9 months, however long we're going to fight through this.
Yeah, gosh, it's going to be a little bit of a slog for a while. But yeah, I think I hear that a lot, that it's you know, still very much a relationship business. And, you know, it shows by the, you know, big personalities for the people in the mortgage business. They like dealing with their customers and reaching out. So I agree with you. It's still going to remain top of mind for everybody. How does APM set themselves apart from their competitors?
A lot of ways. I feel like for the last 12 years, I think, well, first of all, even though I just said, you know, technology is, you know, not the most important thing, it's relationships. I think APM from a tech stack standpoint, just to be able to support branch managers and loan officers and the industry, our technology is really good. And we've kind of, the way that we kind of do it is we kind of narrow, hey, here's your core technology. And here's the other things that we will help support. But, you know, the core technologies that you provide to your originators, I think we do as good a job or better than anyone. I feel very good about that. I do think APM is unique in that, for example, we celebrate the DBA. And sometimes American Pacific Mortgage, some people don't know about American Pacific Mortgage, yet they've done business with one of our branches because it's a DBA branch.
Yeah.
But for us, for whatever reason, I know other companies take a kind of a different tack, and that's, you know, great for them. But for us, it's something to celebrate, because ultimately, particularly from, you know, if you're recruiting branches and stuff like that, but people want to grow their own brand, right? And we like to partner with good brands. And so it doesn't matter if it's an APM brand or if it's a another one of our DBAs, which we have a lot of them. We're able to support that. We're able to support them. You know, our marketing is all driven into their brand, supported by American Pacific Mortgage, or driven, or, you know, powered by APM or whatever. And that really works for us. So I think that's unique for APM. And that's been really great. You know, the other thing, Susan, is, you know, we do have an open platform, and particularly in this, you know, we bank, you know, ultimately we want to bank all of our loans. We believe that, you know, from a product standpoint, we have everything that an originator could want. But periodically there's a program or a product that we may not have. Our open platform allows our loan officers to broker a loan if they need to, which is great. And even now in this time where there's this, you know, the pricing, the challenges with pricing and the pricing, there's some pricing wars going on and stuff like that. Understand that that's just part of the business, and we're okay with that. And we allow our, you know, loan officer to broker a loan if they need to, whatever, you know, whatever we need to do to help them help their customer, we want to be able to do. So that open platform is pretty big. And just, I mean, I guess two other things I talk about is we recently a year ago became an ESOP, or a partial ESOP.
Yeah.
And, you know, employee ownership program has done wonderful things for our organization. It's really been great. It's great from a recruiting standpoint. It helps to say, you know, become part of APM and you become an owner. It's really great for retention. It's really great to keep our best and brightest, whether it's home off, you know, and it's across everybody's an owner or a partial owner, right? And it doesn't matter what your role is, you know, loan officer assistant, processor, loan officer, branch manager, a clerk in the file room, everybody's participating. And it's a really cool way to retain people and get people kind of rowing in the same direction. I felt like over the last, I don't know, the last year and a half, that's been a difference changer, but, you know, kind of a difference maker for us, which is really good. And then, I mean, lastly, I'll just tell you, I mean, you know a little bit about the APM culture, and we definitely have a unique culture, and I think it's a very strong culture, and I think a lot of mortgage companies have great cultures. I personally think that our culture is as good as any in this industry. And it's about teamwork, but it's also about a commitment. It's about communication. I did a video for the home office, about 450 people this morning. Every month we bring transparency and we bring Scrappy to everybody in the company. And the culture is such that everybody's involved. I mean, but there is no channel conflict. We don't, you know, there is no correspondent, there is no wholesale. So we're all, it's all, you know, it's 100% dedicated to making loan officers and branch managers look good. So, you know, from that aspect, from a culture standpoint, from a leadership, you know, the leadership group is here every day. I'm in loans every day, as you know, and I'm happy to do it. And just the ability to talk and communicate with branches and loan officers all the time is pretty sweet. So from a culture standpoint, I think we're as strong as anybody.
I love the culture and the motto of American Pacific. I've had the pleasure of being in meetings in your office there, and I can see that you've got some of the messaging on the wall behind you. So do you want to talk a little bit about how that was developed? Because it's a lot of companies have a lot of great corporate culture, but I'm always very impressed with a company that can establish something like that and stick to it for years and to really make it a core, you know, value of their company.
You know, you got to keep it simple. I mean, we had, when I started here, by the way, like 8 years ago, I think we had 8 or 12 or 22 or so. I don't know how many. We had core values coming out the wazoo. I mean, I couldn't believe how many core values. I was like, man, this is great. Can you remember any of them? No. I mean, I just, you know, it's like, you know, so we got to a point where it's like, we have to be focused on this. And we all have to come together as, what is it that we do? I mean, ultimately we came up with, you know, we're 100% focused on making loan officers and branch managers look good, period, end of story. It took like 2 months of meetings to figure out that's, how do we get behind that message? How, that statement right there, how can we live and breathe being 100% dedicated to making loan officers and branch managers look good? Yeah, it's through respect, it's through transparency. Well, it is behind me. I don't know if it's all behind me, but respect, transparency, and Scrappy. And those are kind of the core values. It's like, who can't remember, you know, three core values? And honestly, particularly, Susan, like today in September of 2022, it's tough, man. Treating people with respect and transparency is very, very important. When things are, you know, in a market like this, we communicate more. The more challenging the market, the more that we communicate, whether it be, you know, with video, weekly videos. Sometimes for a while there, you know, in 2020, we were doing daily videos with everybody in the company just to let people know kind of what's going on.
Right.
But then this year, you know, there's been, you know, in everybody's experience, there's been a reduction in force and a number of companies are really struggling. Some companies have gone out of business. But at the end of the day, you got to live within your core values, right? So you got to treat everybody with respect, and that transparency is like over communicate, so make sure everybody understands what's going on, and so that there's no surprises. And then, you know, ultimately, you know, Scrappy is the that's the one that kind of wins the day, and we have T-shirts with, you know, Scrappy. You know, we have T-shirts that say Scrappy. Some of them are inappropriate. Most of them are appropriate. I won't go into the details, but we have we have a little fox, you know, Scrappy's a fox, and Scrappy is just kind of, the mentality, whatever it takes to get it done. It's right. Whatever it takes to get it done. And this is, you know, we're in a scrappy time. This industry is in a scrappy time. And that's okay. We're going to come out of it. And I feel confident of that. Don't know how long it's going to last, but we all have to be uber scrappy right now. And so that's kind of the, I don't know, man, that culture, keeping it pretty simple. I think everybody can kind of get behind the message. And as long as you communicate, you know, I think you're in pretty good shape.
Right. Yeah, no, I love it. I've always been impressed by that with American Pacific. So, you know, over communicating, make sure that your team knows what's happening with the company and culture, great examples of leadership. And, you know, it's one thing to be a leader in a hot market. Definitely different than being a leader in the year that we're having, that the industry is having in 2022. So what are some of the leadership values that you can share with the audience about navigating through a market like this?
Yeah, man, I would say, first and foremost, don't take too long to make tough decisions. I mean, this is the time when tough decisions have to be made. You got to be lean in these times, and you have to be able to, you need to operate in a little bit of an environment of scarcity, which is okay, but it's smart. You know, at the end of the day, it's about, we're serving customers. Ultimately, our customers, our loan officers, their customers, the consumer, those things can never break. That chain has to never break. But you do have to be, you know, there are decisions that you make that are tough decisions. And like I just talked about, where companies are making tough decisions, financial decisions, and some companies are really struggling. What we are very focused on is, you know, making a decision, be quick about it, be thoughtful about it, be respectful, but move quickly. That's the way to do it. You know, I think about, I'm not a huge book reader, and I'm not that, you know, I've got mentors that, you know, give me books and books, and, you know, but one that I got a while back, The Obstacle is the Way, is kind of a philosophy that I've kind of taken on, which is whatever the problem is, boom, you kind of go right at it. That's your best approach. And your first response is probably your best response. And you have questions about, what should, you know, from a cost perspective, what should stay, what should go. Your gut should probably tell you. You trust your instincts a lot of times, I think, is probably the best way to go. And then I just think, you know, from a leadership standpoint, if you surround yourself with a good team, you got to listen to the team, because that's, ultimately, the ultimate team player. That's what you need. And you need to rely on your team. I certainly rely. We've got an incredibly strong leadership team at APM. I'm blessed to be working with these guys every day. These men and women are just brilliant. Stuff that I just can't, you know, no one person can manage through all of this in like this. So I think ultimately having that ideal team, making sure that you got a group that are, you know, that are humble and hungry and smart and all of those kind of attributes, I think are very important. In this particular time, those leadership values are probably the most important as far as I can tell.
Yeah, fantastic. That's really good information to share. And it's, you know, like I say, it's one thing to lead when times are good, but it's definitely, definitely different when we're going through markets like this. So I tell my current staff, I'm like, which none of them work for me then. I said, you know, I had this job during the financial crisis. So I'm going to assure you of one thing. We're going to be okay. Like, I know what we're doing. Our members are going to be behind us. We, you know, we're on a path forward. Don't get freaked out by the headlines. Like, just one foot in front of the other. We've got a good mission. Let's just stay on it.
Well, you know, and you're absolutely right. And, you know, your point, and I, you know, I say this a lot, you know, it's like, I do have the secrets of success. I know what it takes to be successful. It's just hard freaking work. You know, it is. I mean, it is.
Right.
I mean, you can't, you know, there's no way, you can't get around it. You just can't get around it. You know, I will say that, you know, I told this story real quick just for one little diversion here, Susan. So I've got kids in high school. And so I went to a high school football game on Friday night down in San Francisco. It was like 58 degrees. It was like 50 degrees cooler than it was in Sacramento.
I was going to say half of our temperature.
Yeah. Shout out to San Francisco. But anyway, there was a couple of other dads that had boys on the football team, and that are loan officers that are in the business.
Yeah.
And I was sitting there watching the game. I know both of these gentlemen, and they came up and we talked, and man, what do you think? Business, yeah, kind of crazy. Yeah, it's a little bit different. It feels different. Yeah, this is going to be a tough year. It's going to be another, you know, what do you think, man? It's going to be another 6 months. I don't know what it's going to be. But I thought one of the things that was interesting, and both of these guys work for good companies, but both of them said, I'm not really sure what's going on in my company. I thought that was very interesting. That's just not our, you know, and I get it. And they work for good companies, and I'm sure that they're making the adjustments that they need to make. But you could tell both of those individuals were like, I'm not really sure what's going on. And for us, it's like, you got to be transparent, and you got to bring the information to your people. Because like you said, people are reading the headlines all day, every day.
Right.
Like, you got to get, and some of them's accurate, some of it's not accurate. So you got to make sure that you're getting your message out there. And I think that's very important.
Yeah. Empower your team with information. I completely agree with that. You know, to pivot a little bit, increasing diversity in the mortgage industry is a high priority for the California MBA. We've got a very robust DE&I committee. We do podcast webinars on it. But share with us some information on APM's priorities or strategy around DE&I in your company.
Yeah, that's a good one. And that's a I'm glad that's important to your organization. It's important to our organization. You know, a couple of years ago, we instituted an Office of Diversity at APM because I felt like, you know, a couple of things. We've done a couple of things over the course of the last 2.5 years. And we have a committee that essentially runs that diversity program for APM. But I think, first of all, it's about education. And we spent, you know, 2.5 years ago, we spent a lot of time educating the organization, educating ourselves, the leadership group, everybody. You know, we cascaded down, felt like that was very important. And then ultimately identify gaps in diversity and equity and inclusion in your organization. Understand why it's important, understand how to communicate, you know, because for a lot of people, it's like, yes, I'm in favor. What do I, you know, I don't know what to do. How do I advance the ball? So we spent a lot of time educating ourselves, educating the organization, identifying gaps. And then, you know, we kind of grade ourselves against our peers, but we also may ultimately, you know, grade ourselves against ourselves. And each year we have a strategic planning sessions every year. At the end of every year, we have a 2-day offsite strategic plan. And then every 90 days, we go through we update our strategic plan. Diversity, equity, inclusion, and belonging is always part of our strategic plan. So it never gets missed each year. And then each quarter, that's one of the items that we talk about. And how have we done so far? Where are our gaps? How do we fill those gaps? You know, one of the other cool things I think we've done here is we have an internship, you know, the Fannie Mae Future Leaders has a program. And it's essentially to get an understanding of this business into underserved areas, right? And so for the last two years, maybe three years, certainly the last 2 years, we brought on interns into that program with APM, and they've worked at APM, and where otherwise they would not have had exposure to the business that we're in. It has been great. It's been great for the, we probably had 10 or 15 people grow through that internship program. A couple of people have actually stayed and are now employees with APM, which I think is very cool too. But to be able to do that, and we plan on doing that every year, and to expand awareness of our industry in those areas. It's been great for us. It's probably been better for us as a company than perhaps for the interns, because some of them are going like, God, this business sucks.
Like, how many people?
Sometimes it does. But for those of us who have stuck it out, it's been good. And so that's been a really good program for us.
Sounds like a really successful program. Good for you guys.
Yeah.
So American Pacific has been a longtime supporter of the California MBA, and we are very appreciative of that support. Ending our podcast, can you talk with us a little bit about the importance of companies supporting organizations like the California MBA?
Susan, I think you guys are doing great work. I really do. I'm, strength in numbers, right? I mean, your level of advocacy for the industry in the state of California is it couldn't be done without an organization like the CMBA. It just would not happen individually. Not only are we not as strong individually, we're not skilled to do it. You've got the background, you got the skill, you got the experience. So I think from an advocacy standpoint, it's unbelievable. So I'm really grateful that you guys are doing what you do. Secondly, man, the functions that you put on, the networking, the ability to meet new people, the ability to, whether it's, forget about just from a business aspect, but, some of my best friends are people in the business that I've met through, events that you put on, or just the kind of networking events like that, or, industry events, what I think are very, very important for us to succeed. And then, you do a lot of education too, right? And ultimately you help those of us who are going 100 miles an hour. You do a lot of, I just think back in the TRID, just all sorts of things that you guys have delivered for us, the industry. Really, I'm thrilled. I'm honored that we're a part of it. And I'm very appreciative of what the work that you guys do, because it's invaluable in my opinion.
Well, thank you. And again, we do appreciate your support. You're right. We are stronger together. There is strength in numbers. So we'll hopefully maintain that throughout these tough year or so that we've got ahead of us. So Ned, thank you so much for being a part of the Connect podcast. It was a pleasure having you on.
Well, it was my pleasure. Thank you, Susan. Thank you personally for what you're doing and the organization doing a great job. So thanks. Thanks for the time. And I appreciate you very much.
Thank you. Appreciate that. And thanks to all of you for joining us on today's Connect podcast episode. To access any of our past episodes, you can follow us on our YouTube channel. We're also available on Apple Podcasts, SoundCloud, and Spotify. That's it for this week, and we'll see you next time on Connect.